been given the sacrifice. We've been given the Sri Lanka is awakening after 30 years. The future of Sri Lanka. When he has just made it our production team are all working to reach the and that future, I leave the and welcome to another program of Checkmate. My guest tonight happens to be the first third generation old girl of Ladies College to become the principal. She began her career way away in Trincomalee. She was attached to the Education Ministry then, and she taught chemistry, botany, zoology to A-level students. She then taught at a number of other schools. Thereafter, she joined her husband in Seychelles, where in addition to the science subject, she taught a very unique combination in literature as well. She is a proven educationist. She joined the British school thereafter and left British school in 2003 to take on the post of principal of Ladies College Colombo. She has served and continues to serve on several committees. She was a member of the National Education Commission from 2003 to 2005. She holds her first degree in science. She also holds a diploma in teaching, Trinity College London, diploma in preschool education, a certificate as a trained teacher and trained counselor, and a number of other similar qualifications for educationists. Mrs. Nirmali Wickramasinghe, Aibon, welcome to Checkmate.
Krishmal. You left out an important thing there. I was also the vice principal of Bishop's College.
You were also the vice principal of Bishop's
between,
College.
Between Seychelles and the British school.
Yes. I stand correct.
Yes.
Education, I believe, was never meant as you started your career. You never intended to be an educationist, but you ended up there.
Yes. I would say that I really didn't know what I intended to be at all, right? I firmly believe in God, and God took me this whole distance. When I married as a young woman of 22, went to Trincomalee, there was no other job for me to do. So I went in for teaching, and I really felt that was my calling. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed being with children, and it has been so for the last 36 years.
So that could have been the other point that we noted. I mean, some of us are left brain, they say, some of us are right brain.
Yes.
You seem to be multiple brain. You have taught the sciences.
Yes.
And you also taught literature.
Yes.
How did this come up?
Well, I would say I am very, very interested in the arts. I've always been. I've been interested in drama, in literature, in history, and though I studied science, I never gave up that side of my interests. So it was
it was easier for you to teach both sides.
And also I pursued the literature part also with my Trinity College London examinations and theatre and drama. Mm. I was on the stage.
Mm. Can I just take you back to the Trincomalee experience?
Yes.
From Trincomalee, you've taught at several other government institutions.
Yes.
Before you came to Ladies College. Do you want to speak a little bit about that experience in the state sector? I'm sure that would have stood you in good.
Oh, yes. I am so grateful for the fact that I had that experience in the state sector, because it was there that it was my first experience of teaching children at all, and I was exposed to co-education for the first time, having gone to a school where there were only girls, teaching in a school where there was co-education, girls and boys. That was an experience. And altogether, the state experience held out so much of variety and understanding of children, understanding of the education system of the country, understanding of the people of the country, venturing out into Trincomalee, into Nigambo, culturally different places, then back to Nugegoda, where it was only a boys' school.
Now, from all this, you come to ladies' college. Now, when we speak of ladies' college, the common perception is that several people want to get their girls in there. Arguably, one of the leading, if not the leading, private schools, girls' schools in the country that still follows the national curriculum. And I take you to your principal's report of 2010. And I quote from what you've said in your speech. You were speaking of your chief guest, and you said, "We're inordinately proud of our old girls who have ventured into a range of professions and risen to great heights. Women who have carried the LC spirit and ethos out of these gates into the country and into the world." What's this LC ethos? What's the spirit?
Well, I would like to quote my founder principal who came to ladies, who came to Sri Lanka 11 years ago. And she said it in really three words. She said, independent, upright, and not pretentious. I think those were three very important words for character. Mm. And for LC ethos, I would definitely say a balanced education, where you give the due place to academia, but you look beyond that. You look beyond that, you look at extracurricular activities, you look at the whole of learning, not just book learning, but you learn.
Is it this often quoted integrated education?
Yes, definitely. Integrated.
Right, so
yes. Integrated in every sense of the word, where you not only participate actively in all forms of the multiple intelligence, I would say, the different types of education,
it's
the different types of intelligence.
It's interesting that you said. I wanted to bring you to that next one.
Yes.
I quote from you once again, and this is, you're a great lover of quotes, I hear. Mm. You say that, "I believe IQ tests are a poor way to judge a person's ability, failing as they do to account for the magic which has its own importance, both by itself and as an accomplishment to logic."
Yes.
You want to explain to us what you mean?
Definitely, because I would say an integrated personality can definitely not be judged only by the person's IQ. Because you need the three quotients. You need IQ, you need EQ, which is the emotional quotient, and you need the spiritual quotient, which is SQ. And an integrated person should have all three. An integrated person should also be able to, if you have all three, be able to at least appreciate the different types of abilities that are there, which they should be exposed to. And I think in a balanced education, you would be exposed to all that. I think all schools in the country do have this range of activities, but you wouldn't find all the children being sufficiently interested in all that. You would
I wanted to bring you to that, Ms. Wickramasinghe. Now, definitely that's a point that we'll go to in our next segment.
Yeah,
but very quickly before we wrap up this first part of the program. So you make it a point to teach your girls out of the set down curriculum.
Yes.
Is social service and venturing out to society also part of it?
It is very much a part of the ladies' college ethos, because we are always made aware of the fact that we need to reach out to everybody in the country. And when we say reach out, it means to people who are in difficulties, people who need us, because no man is an island. I am very particular that the children spend time, not just giving of things, but giving of their time to other people, including, I always say, go out even to an uncle or an aunt or a grandparent who is alone, who would like your company. Because I believe that reaching out is a very, very important part of the development of a person.
Right. We're going to come to that development that you speak of, that you've managed to inculcate in your girls in a little while, just after this. Welcome back. Mrs. Wickramasinghe, do the girls at Ladies College also follow the national curriculum?
Yes. We are a private school within the education ministry and we follow the national curriculum.
And in addition to that, you were speaking of co-curricular activities that you have brought into the system.
Yes.
Itself. Is this not too demanding? Because already we've had educationists on the program before who say that following the set down curriculum itself is difficult. And you're speaking of bringing more things to make your integrated education. How do you manage that?
Well, one thing, Krishmali, is that Ladies College has always been a school where, though we followed the national curriculum, we always padded it up. And today, in today's world, the children are being bombarded. I mean, they are being subject to all their senses being excited, isn't it? Much more than in our time. I mean, the neon lights, the loud music, their taste buds with all the, you know, I think all their senses are being excited much more than in our time. And consequently, I think they want an exciting life all the time. So the curriculum itself, I don't think serves this purpose.
And Which brings me, the curriculum itself doesn't serve the purpose.
Yeah.
So you pat them up by several things.
Ladies College always did.
Yeah.
We always had more than what the national curriculum gave, and although the national curriculum is very intense and extensive, the co-curricular activities that we introduce is more exciting, more research-oriented, and the children just lap it up.
So this brings me back, Mrs. Wickramasinghe, taking a step back. I see that you seem to have your own issues as well with the policy. I quote from your report in 2009,
yeah,
where you're saying, during the last century, we have witnessed several attempts at education reform. You're talking back in 1948.
Yeah.
But then you top it up by saying the 1995 reforms concentrated heavily on the shift from didactic teacher-centered teaching to student-based child-centered learning. And then you also say that activities and projects were introduced to try to teach children to learn through discovery, to research, as opposed to being taught and reproducing.
Yes.
Now, you seem to have had issues with the policies that constantly kept changing. And because you go on thereafter to say, as educationists, while being mindful of the need for change in education policy, we would have liked to see more far-sighted and focused planning. In theory, every concept in the reform agenda was excellent, but the implementation had been slow and labored process, even with Ladies College being a private school which had more autonomy and much more advantages. So what's the difficulty that you face in the policy?
The understanding of the shift from teacher-centered to student-centered was not it happened very fast. So I really think the teachers, there were training programs, but I am not very sure whether the teachers really adapted to it in that manner. And even now, there is a lot of teacher-centered learning going on in the country, because one thing is that with such huge syllabuses and such oppressive exams at the end of it, right? The teachers are also, they are in a very, very difficult situation. Even if they would like to open it out into much more child-centered teaching, because the school-based assessments that were introduced, a lot of it is research-based, and you're supposed to use different tools, right? They learn through drama, they learn through music, they learn through dancing, they learn through research, they learn through modeling.
Yeah, but you're trying to say is that
the resources
to teach the children,
yeah,
the teachers also need to be trained.
They need to be trained. There was training,
right.
I won't say there wasn't.
Right.
But one thing, the teachers need to be trained. Other thing is, all the schools should have the resources, the libraries, all that. And I definitely feel that the resources still, in many places, is insufficient. The understanding also sometimes, I think, is insufficient of the whole, all of the shift. Although there was a lot of training done, and it was a necessary shift because everybody became aware that, you know, you tell me I forget, you show me I may remember, you involve me, I will remember.
So that's the whole idea of this dialogue.
Yeah.
So I mean, we are all aiming towards the ideal policy.
Yes.
So together with policy, you need to also establish and put in place teacher training and also the facilities to. Now, this takes me to another interesting point that was commented upon by another educationist, which you also seem to have some issues with.
Yeah.
You, in 2009, you advised parents. I advise parents to be aware that tuition teachers are sometimes totally exam oriented and that they do not use methodology that stimulate the children to discover, research, create and be innovative.
Yes.
And you top it up in 2010.
Yes.
I am glad that we found all this. You say that the country needs creative thinkers and the damage done in the name of education that is confined to a set of marks will result in individuals with tunnel vision leaving the school. How have you grappled, if at all, with the tuition problem?
I'm grappling. I'm still grappling. And I think as long as I still remain in I remain in education, we will be grappling with it. I have come to the conclusion that we have come to the point of no return with tuition in this country.
Hmm.
Because of the reason that I spoke to you about. Very large syllabuses that school teachers find impossible to complete. Now, yesterday's Daily Mirror had a very interesting article where the World Bank has referred to large syllabuses, because what I have found, Krishmal, is with revision of syllabuses, you find that there is a lot of additions. Revisions of syllabuses should be done in a way that you keep you modernize the syllabuses, you glean and you take off what is not necessary, and you put in what is really necessary for the child to go into research and application. I would say application also there. Mm. But what is happening is that with every revision of a syllabus, there are reams of stuff being added to the syllabus, which means that the teacher has to teach to so much more. So what happens then is what ultimately happens is that the teacher has hardly any time for revision, right? And the marking is definitely on a very precise mark scheme.
The examination is set by others.
So it's on a very precise mark scheme. And the children feel very insecure.
Yes, but then that's what I want to pick up on.
Yeah.
Now, what do parents do in such a situation, if we admit that the teacher can't cope up with the syllabus, you comment on to say that teachers
now at Ladies College, the teachers definitely cover the syllabus.
Yes.
That I'm sure of. They try to do as much revision as possible.
Yes.
We have seminars and things like that.
Yes. No, but you seem to be addressing a different point here. That's what I'm trying to get out.
Yeah.
What you're trying to say is that there is no choice for teachers and tutors to be boxed up in these confines.
Yes.
That children oscillate between them in the pursuit of examination.
So that is what I'm saying. Despite the fact that in school you cover the syllabuses, and up to a point you do the revision and the quite a bit of it, the children are so scared and the parents are so scared, they do not have the confidence that they can manage only with the schoolwork. And with such large syllabuses, they feel that they have to top it up with tuition. And it has become now like A is taking, A tells B, I'm taking, and it goes on.
How do you handle this problem? And surely, we have to handle the problem. We all accept, tuition is needed.
I don't accept that tuition is needed, because there are many children who do not go for tuition. Those are children who are quite confident that they can handle it on their own. But you have a large number of children and large number of parents also who don't have that confidence. I think it's very important that children grow up realizing that they can manage without it and depend on themselves and their reading matter, maybe a little research, without being so scared of this exam. I think that examination fear is something that we need to remove, both from children and from parents. So through absolute fear of the examination, through wanting to get 8 A's because A, B, C, and D are getting 8 A's, which is totally unnecessary. I don't think you have to get A's in all the subjects that you are doing. There is so much fear connected with examinations that the way that they overcome this fear is thinking that if they learn from about two, three people, that they are going to reach the target.
Right. Now, that point of exam is something I want to pick up on. We've had a comment here on this very Checkmate forum that we seem to have somehow left out what you seem to be seeking also in the child, the creativity. That the example used, I believe, was, for example, in Sri Lanka, we would ask in Oliver Twist, when who said, please, sir, can I have more? Who said to whom at what time? But whereas in another system, the question may be asked, what was Dickens trying to say when with the comment, please, sir, can I have some more? Now, are we making the child aware of the creativity that's supposed to come out with our examination techniques, or do we need to improve?
Definitely, I think examination techniques have to improve all the time, wherever, whichever exam, whether it be a Sri Lankan exam or a foreign exam, I think that has to evolve. And I think both types of questions are being asked, even in our papers, in Sri Lanka, both types of questions are being asked. I don't agree that it is a totally rote system at all. But at the end of that type of question being asked, the mark scheme would stipulate the answer. So I think that's where there is the problem. The type of questioning, the creative questions are also being asked.
What's the point in the child answering that question using his creativity if the examiner is being given a draft answer and say, okay, if this does not come within the parameters of this draft, you don't give marks?
It is very necessary that there has to be alternative answers as well, you know, and people who mark should not think that they have to have a total objective paper in front of them for marking, because they should be sufficiently aware of the subject matter to be able to mark a creative answer. So the questions themselves are not like directly expecting a rote answer.
Right.
Neither do the children. I really wouldn't say that we are a nation of rote learners. I don't, because having worked in so many schools, I know how creative children are.
Right.
In government service, the children are extremely creative. You give them anything, a drama will come, overnight a kavi will come, a song will come, you know, they're very, very intelligent children. The tuition thing is really up to a point, because objective answers are needed, but more, in my opinion, is the absolute fear
that you might,
and they are clutching onto something, and what they are clutching onto is the tuition teacher, fear of the children and the parents, and they think that the tuition teacher is going to be some magician or genie that's going to give the A. Whereas the children who are confident in themselves do not go for tuition. Even at ladies, there are children I have letters where mothers have written to me and said, we didn't send our children. In fact, last year we had a student who did very well.
I know that she
was not a tuition person who was running from one tutor to the other.
Congratulations to LC and you on that. Well, we have much more coming up with Mrs. Wickramasinghe, but before we go on to our next break and get on to our last segment, which is going to be very interesting, I need to tell you that you need to engage yourself. The whole idea of this program is that we build a new Sri Lanka together. We've come out of a seriously long conflict. Many of our generation only went to war, some never came back. But Sri Lanka and the future generations have been given a future. So you need to engage with us in these dialogues. You need to write into us. At the bottom of the screen, you'll see our Facebook page appearing. We're also on email. You'll see the email address. Write into us, communicate, participate. That's the only way that we will have this dialogue and maintain this dialogue and make Checkmate something worthwhile that we can use to build a new Sri Lanka. We'll be back straight after this break. Welcome back. We are on the last segment of Checkmate with Mrs. Nirmali Wickramasinghe, the principal of Ladies College, who quotes in her report Wilde, Oscar Wilde. Talking of theatre, you say that the most immediate way in which a human being can share with another the sense of what it is to be a human being is personified by theatre. You go on to say how true this is. Drama extracts from our inner being the deep understanding of human nature, fortifying us to interact with understanding. Now, when I was in your office, I was moved. I was deeply moved to see that girl, a differently able girl, who was a teacher in your special needs unit, who had given you this lovely card, which I stole from your desk to have a read of, and these brochures, which we will also show you all about the diploma in special needs education. What made you start this unit in school? Is that part of your spirituality, reaching out?
Well, spirituality, in my opinion, is the development of your inner being, which shows in your outer personality. I think one of the most important things about spirituality is humility. And I believe that if you are a person whose inner being is truly spiritual, you would be able to associate with anybody on this earth and make that person feel comfortable.
But this girl was very, very attached to you. I realized how, she almost had a very deep spiritual connection with you as being part of the school. So what made this whole thing come?
So that is what I said, what I was trying to tell you, Krishmal, is that if you are, if your inner being is developed, you would be able to connect with any human being. That is very important. And today it's an era of inclusive education. You don't exclude anybody from your wherever you work, your immediate surroundings. You don't include any. You don't exclude anybody. And in a school, everywhere, all over the world, they talk of inclusive education, where you would encourage every type of person to come in. Now, as you know, in our schools, we have students of all ethnic communities, all religions, and I think that's the greatest contribution we make to this country, our multicultural ethos. But apart from that, we also need to accommodate people who are different, and whom other people consider different, so that when they come into our community, they are no longer different. They become a part of us. And from the time I came into higher administration, this has always been one of the things that I have wanted to do.
So when did the unit come around? When was it?
After I came in as principal. I came in as principal at Ladies College in 2003. I started this unit in 2004.
Which is specifically for children with special needs. I also noticed another interesting aspect of it, that you don't seem to have stopped with the child.
Yes.
But you seem to have also given employment to those children who grow up to be individuals with special needs.
I believe that we have to take it to another level. We include them into the school. Or into our schools. All over the world there's inclusive education and they're included. But if we stop at that point and do not then include them into society,